I got to watch Flummox do a few covers, and I was like, wow, this band's pretty cool. I guess hopefully I won't join them in a month.
Oh, hey, Alice. Good timing.
What?
I got Flummox with me. The Flummies.
Flummies. So,
Alice, you remember Blake from last time, from In Hindsight, when that album got released. And we also have Max Mowberry and Chase McCutcheon. Am I saying that right?
Yeah, it's McCutcheon. It's close enough. Most people completely butcher it. So you did a very good job. Thank you.
Oh.
Chase McCutcheon.
And this is a momentous time for the Flummies, because there's another new album coming out, Reflummoxed, April 1st.
That's right.
There is a show at the Basement that same day. Who else is on that bill? That's Isolation Tank Ensemble, is that right?
Yep. And there's some Louisville friends of ours. They're a very weird avant-garde art rock prog rock sort of thing. And then Look What I Did as well, playing with those fucking legends.
Yeah, that's gonna be a great show. I'm really excited about that. And there's on top of all of that, y'all just released a new video as well, the Hummingbird Anthem. And that was a lot of fun. That came out yesterday, right?
Yeah. Just popped it out yesterday, and it took a lot of effort from Haven to animate all of that, and it came out better than I expected by a lot.
Yeah, y'all have a long track record of good videos, so like it's hard to say what's my favorite, but that's definitely up there. I enjoy this one a lot.
I think it's my favorite so far.
It's the most unforgettable.
Yeah, for sure.
So was that based on a real life story, that song?
Well, I mean, it's a story that certainly is very near and dear to me and Drew's hearts. Mm. Because we used to day trip a lot back in high school, and you know how it goes, is me and Drew and a friend of ours went out into the woods, and what can I say? We came across a hummingbird while we were tripping. And usually any kind of bird is going to like fly away from you or doesn't even let you see it in the first place, but not this one. This one flew around us and was our pal. He was a good hummingbird, but we were tripping, you see. And we sat there and we thought, what does this mean? You know, we're all tripping out. Like, there's this hummingbird is our friend, and this means something because we're all tripped out. And what should we do about this? And Drew was the one who suggested we should smoke it. And that's kind of how it goes.
And so it's
the hummingbird.
Yeah.
You know. So they say.
Yeah.
So they say.
Well, that's Hummingbird was a good sacrifice. I mean, it's sad that any loss of life is a tragedy, but this was worth it for the sake of art. So
I'm like the ancient mariner who has to go around retelling my story about how I killed the albatross.
Yeah.
Only in this case, it's how I smoked a hummingbird.
I believe that story has remained relatively unchanged in the years since, as far as I'm aware. I don't know.
True.
So speaking of releases, Max, you just put out your own album recently as well.
I did do that.
A couple months ago. Max has a band called Others by None, and you just released an album called Book Two. I just recently listened to this, and it was a ton of fun. So can we talk about, first of all, I'm curious how you came to be with Flummox, if that's a story that we can share.
Kidnapped.
Oh, okay.
It was a whole thing.
Max, that's illegal. I know. We wouldn't do that.
We're telling stories, and this is my story. This is my truth. How I got involved with Flummox, is that what the question was?
Yeah.
Yeah, sure. Because Others by No One is my baby. We put out the book record in October now. And both these groups are very much in the same artistic wheelhouse. So Flummox is a very theatrical live entity with a lot of diversity. And Others by No One is similarly limitless. And once Flummox got on my radar, I went, that's someone I should at least, be tangentially aware of. And so I became friends with them. I covered one of their tunes on YouTube, and they were like, okay, and they knew who I was. And then a few months later, I ended up coming down to Nashville for a few different things, and I hooked up with the Flummox gang. And it turns out they needed a guitar player for a gig because Chase messed up his wrist and doing his job. And I filled in on guitar for the band's first show after the pandemic had happened. And I kind of made a position for myself within the group, just kind of was around, and I started writing with everybody, and that went really well, and has continued to go really well. We're actually pretty deep into writing the follow-up record, because again, Reflummoxed is a collection of old stuff that's been completely rearranged and revitalized through this lineup we have now. But we're writing the next one together right now. And it's been going, it's some of the most interesting music I've ever heard, or different at least. So it makes sense that we would cross paths, I think, eventually. It was kind of inevitable, I think.
Yeah, that makes sense. It's like, it was bound to happen eventually. Yeah. I've seen many, iterations of Flummox, and I think this might be my favorite lineup. So
it, best one.
Yeah, y'all are doing a lot of good stuff. It's fun.
We try to do our best. We try to we try to amp it up with whoever is willing to be a part of it at the time, at any given point. And I agree. Like, this is definitely the most proficient, most talented lineup that we've had, and we all get along really well, and the way we've been writing together is really interesting. I think one reason we chose to do, before this, Max is barely on the new album because she joined right as we were finishing it. But the reason we chose to do that re-recorded stuff in the first place is really just because we wanted to take some time writing the next one. Because we have a lot to say with it. And frankly, we've already gotten, it's almost like we kind of got a head start in a way, because it's like we had an album's worth of material that, we didn't have to write, essentially. We just had to rearrange it and re-record it and that sort of thing. And then from there, we are basically just sitting on most of a new album already, so.
What number album is this for Flummox?
Well, it depends on, well, I kind of consider at this point Flummoxygen and Zelkuth to be demo albums, the stuff that we did with Tridroid, because we just didn't have the production value. And I feel like the first true Flummox album for me is Intellectual Hooliganism. So if from that point forward, so this would be our second album, sort of, but also our fourth.
Okay.
Yeah.
Gotcha. Yeah, this depends how you look at it. Glass half full. Really. Yeah.
What's that?
Is this perspective?
Yeah, of course.
So this is something that I ask everybody, and I know I already asked Allie this last time she was here. Feel free to weigh in on it again if you have anything else to add. But I would like to go around. Let's start with Chase, since he's a bit quiet. Chase, I'm putting you on the spot. What do you think happens after we die?
What do I think happens after we die?
Yeah, thoughts on the afterlife.
Well, that's a deep question. We could sit here and talk about for hours, but my personal belief, I am Christian. I believe in the Bible. I'm not your typical Christian nationalist type of religious person. That's like the hee-haw, God bless the USA type. Certainly not that. I think that Americanized Christianity is a bastardized version of what the religion is supposed to be about. It's all used for guns and Republicans. Jeez, it's misused in a way that it shouldn't be. So, long story short, I am a Christian, but not the example of a Christian that you see in today's multimedia.
I gotcha. And it's funny how, like, that only brings me a little bit closer to what you think happens when we die, because there's so many different versions of what that mean, like you're bringing out. It's like, not necessarily like the like super fundamental, but you, yeah. So,
well, if I had to guess, like, you know, because I ultimately have the viewpoint that like, we don't know shit. You know, humans think we're so smart because we have iPhones and computers, but like, we don't know jack shit about the universe and the origins of it and where it came from. So it's, I've always had trouble really answering that question, but if I had to guess, I would just kind of go by what, you know, the words in red say. So, you know, heaven, hell, that kind of thing. But again, what do I know?
Who knows? I like to preface that question with, no one on this planet knows the answer to that. But I think we all have different ideas of what it could be. Different.
For sure.
Yeah. What about you, Max? Do you have any preconceptions?
I think every shitty album I've ever heard will meet me at the gates of hell and play it once. And then I will die a second death. And then and then I will die a second death, and I will still be playing in this fucking band. That's what I think happened. But that's the closest to a real answer you're going to get from me. What do you think, Allison?
When I go to hell, I can't honestly beat what Max just said. I'm not going to try to top that. I'll answer somewhat seriously. I don't know, and I don't care.
Yes. So, okay. That's beautiful.
Thanks.
The best answer I've ever had to that question was what you just said. And Sarah Rose from Sarah and the Safe Word, I think y'all just played with them in Chattanooga recently.
Yeah.
She said, that was her answer. And that exactly what you just said. And well, that is the best answer.
Isn't it fun? Isn't it fun, Max?
Yes.
That is my favorite answer, is it doesn't matter.
I'm not at all surprised that she said that either.
Right?
Not at all.
Yeah.
Not at all.
But yeah, it doesn't matter. What matters is what we're doing right now, you know, or not, you know, we're not right now, but
rocking and rolling.
Yeah.
For money.
I definitely agree.
We got money. We get that.
For the love of music and me having a place to live.
Okay. I just like the attention.
Yeah, of course you would.
We know.
Do you want to say to a point one thing on a serious note? I know we're all clamming around and stuff about this, but I like want to say that, you know, I do take it somewhat seriously, and I hope that I wasn't like a total buzzkill with that answer.
No, not at all.
I appreciate how open-minded Flummox is to different cultures, beliefs, religions, you know, because I mean, there's a lot of lyrical content in the songs that, you know, point to like Satan or like a lot of things that at surface level seem like a, you know, a dig at Christianity. And in a way it is, it's Christian nationalism that's the issue. And I just like that they're so open-minded and understand that not every Christian is what you would see depicted. And they've always accepted that from me. So I just want to give like an appreciation and a shout out to them because they've never given me any shit for it at all. And I think that's awesome.
Absolutely not. We value perspective in this group. I mean, clearly, if you look at the people who are in it, and yeah, I mean,
we needed a token white straight Christian in the band. Otherwise, people were going to start saying that we were being prejudiced.
Yeah,
I am the token straight.
That band is too gay.
Yeah.
We got to put the kibosh on this. But yes, Chase is absolutely right.
Yeah. And Chase, you make a good point too, because I think like that's really important to keep to do that, right? Like, because something I notice is like the freaks and the geeks are, and like people that got picked on in the 90s, they're cool now. We're like, it's or cooler. Like, basically what I'm getting at is being a cheerleader jock, I mean, I guess there are still circles of that, but that's mostly like a meme at this point. And anyone, it's more about expression, I feel like. But something I'm realizing is people that got bullied when they were younger, now that they're in a position of being in a place where they have affluence, become the jocks and the cheerleaders instead of like bringing people up. And so, I mean, I appreciate Flummox for that reason too. You're not stepping on anybody. It's not like, fuck you normies. You're not witch burning the Catholics, you know?
I am definitely just going to throw out there that I am not a normie. We'll just say I'm straight white male, but I wouldn't call myself a normie.
Chase
is in Flummox.
He is in Flummox. Like that was going to be my point. If Chase couldn't hang, I mean, he couldn't hang. He wouldn't be, he's been in the band longer than Max and Jesse, you know, so I mean he's been hanging around for a bit and he hangs around forever and ever and ever.
Yeah, we all know what this band is about for sure. Yeah. And definitely that's a big reason why it works, you know, just everybody fits in this little piece. I think Ellie shared it once. It was a picture of us and was like, you know, none of these people would necessarily be in the same band otherwise. I don't know if that's quite true, but you know,
if you took somebody out of like specific like a specific kind of band and just put them all together, I mean, I think it'd be like us, you know. I don't like, none of us like are always, I mean, I think none of us are really always listening to the same kind of music or, you know, doing the same kind of things with our lives outside of Flummox, you know. But we all come together at least once a week, at least. And we're like the best, we're best friends. We're all best friends, really. You know, we all talk to each other about some pretty heavy things and we help each other out in life or whatever needs to get done, you know? And, you know, that none of like the bullshit, you know, ideologies and things like that matter. I mean, obviously none of us carry hate in our hearts either, mm-hmm. you know, but, you know, obviously the finer details don't necessarily matter as long as, you know, we're all in it for the same reasons and have a good heart about all of it.
Yeah, for sure.
I also, forgive me for interjecting again. I apologize. I'm about to have to go turn over the next band on Broadway, or I'm working on Broadway downtown right now, which is why I'm.
We got it covered, bro. You're fine.
Come back.
So, were there any questions that you had about like the production process or anything you might need from me before I have to get off here?
You're mastering the newest record coming out, right?
So I did the mixing. We did the mastering through Angel Hair Audio. And she did a fantastic job. Very easy to work with, like nailed it within the second draft or third draft. Like she did great. So shout out to her. But I did the mixing.
Did y'all track it anywhere specific or with anybody in particular?
Mainly between our houses.
All right.
during the pandemic, really.
Yeah.
We recorded most of the record before the mandate lifted. Like shows weren't happening yet.
Right, right.
Hmm.
All right, yeah. And so y'all pretty much did the recording and the mixing in-house.
In-house.
And Jay's doing wonderful. Yeah.
Yes,
I listened to that track and it produced in house.
Mm-hmm.
The track that y'all just put up, Hummingbird. I listened to that earlier, and that is something else. I'm glad to see better quality going up. other than just the quality of the gear. You know, what I see a lot now is really good bands, really good music, and even it's a good video, but the ambition is there, but it's almost like they got better equipment than they really should have had because they'd have probably done a more copacetic thing with something less. But that's one of the first videos that I've seen from a local or regional band that's really pushing top notch, you know, audio wise and even visually wise. I mean, it's really something else. I was really blown away by it.
So, hey, thank you so much. I mean, that's a huge compliment.
Anybody that knows me as an engineer knows I'm pretty goddamn critical. So,
hell yeah. Yeah,
hey, Chase, I appreciate the compliment.
Chase pushed it to the next level on this one for sure. That was definitely one of the fun parts about this. I mean, it was a lot to get it all done, but definitely, I mean, because I was, like Ali said, I stepped in at the very end of the recording process, and when mixing was starting and working with Chase couldn't have been smoother. You know, it was like walking into something where everybody was just very democratic and but had the skills and the knowledge to get it to sound what it needed to sound like, you know.
It comes across that y'all have y'all's fluidity with each other translates in y'all's recording, because something I've noticed with you guys is y'all's prog. You know, not a lot of people can push prog in a direction that is as palatable
or progressive.
Yeah, as far as, you know, we're right. That's funny. But, you know, I mean, musically, not necessarily topically, but just, you know, musically, as far as like prog rock goes. And one of the things that I've always lined up with you guys is what I've noticed y'all's influences, or at least what I pick up. And then I also, you know, when I see in videos and pictures, I notice the other band stuff you wear is almost in line. I mean, like Melvin's is literally probably my favorite band on the planet. You know, Mr. Bungle is
Blue Sniffer.
Yeah. Mr. Bungle is one of those obscurities that only us real heads know about. You know what I'm saying? So a lot of that really comes across. And I'm glad to see that, because y'all translate it well to where it's not obvious. I don't see y'all trying to be these other bands, because these other bands are not the kind of bands that try to be anybody else, you know? So that's why, you know, and that, you know, I wanted to throw that out there. It's, you know, kudos on that, because I was really impressed with this track. It's, y'all've got a very, I mean, y'all go from bluegrass to almost show tune in this thing, and it's, yeah, it's something else, you know?
It's, you know, like, I mean, we try to make music that doesn't already exist, or rather music that we want to hear ourselves. Like, right. It's the kind of stuff that, you know, we would like to hear out in the world and out in the ether, you know, and we're not really making it for anybody else. So it's there's no reason for us to limit it in with the genre or dynamics or what we choose to write about, what we choose to do next. And that's like the beauty of this band for me, is because like we can literally put out any style of music if we want to, and it'll fit, because we've never really settled for just one sound. Like every single one of our records sounds different, even though this album we're about to put out is a bunch of re-recorded arrangements. Doesn't sound like those albums, because it's completely rearranged and re-recorded and redone. And like, if we, you know, that's why, you know, Chase, you know, with all the hard work and effort and everything we did in the mixing and everything, like, you know, we wouldn't have gone through all of that if, you know, we were just going to like only half-ass it, you know, we weren't going to try to re-record it in that regard. And like, unless we had it like down to a science. And with those songs in particular, we just felt like they could, you know, live to be something bigger than they were, you know, because we just weren't really happy with the way that those first two records sounded altogether.
Right.
So, you know.
Yeah. But, you I know. mean, we're we're definitely all Mr. Bungle fans too. I mean, California is one of those records for me where I heard it and I was like, you can clearly draw like a through line to all the things that maybe could comprise music like Mr. Bungle's, you know, or ours. But at the end of the day, the way it's like, well, there's little elements of pop or little elements of blues or like you said, show tunes, rock metal. But the way it comes together is something so interesting, which is even more interesting to me that the Hummingbird song was written, you know, 6 or 7+ years ago. Right. And although it's been rejuvenated through the perspectives we currently share and the music we currently listen to, I still struggle to even think about what to call a song like that. Because the other day I was like, well, it's not really a bluegrass song. It just has elements of that. But it's not really a metal song because it's not like a full-on metal thing. And it kind of has the bluesy swing in the middle. It's like, it's just this horrible abomination. And I think that's us. We're just a lot of things happening at once. And it's hard to tell what all is happening. And I think that's why we go over so well. And I'm really glad you like the song so much, by the way. That's one of my favorite ones. Yeah. That was the first one I contributed to, or at least on the record. So nice. I did the banjo and a couple other things.
Nice.
The fact that y'all are doing exactly what y'all want to do and y'all are enjoying it, you know, it's like different projects I've been in, you know, I've done things where I was a part of the project. It wasn't necessarily mine. And it was music that was for people to listen to and for the people.
You guys don't make music for people,
you know, and then
I was just thinking that
we make them for goblins.
Right. Yeah. And it's when you music, you know, a lot of people tell me some of the things that I'll do is it's musicians music. Sometimes it comes across. So you get a different, other musicians give you a different appreciation. It's not necessarily better or worse. I guess you can value it on your own how you want it, but it's, you know, in some bands, as good as they are, and I can love what they do, they are strictly, and that's what like a pop band to me is, you know, that's the genre of pop. It's when you are strictly doing what is palatable. And y'all seem to take what would almost seem unpalatable and, you know, some of it I really like the intensity is like force feeding, but it's not unenjoyable. You know, it's like force feeding
I like that.
Force feeding me on a cheat day. I'm like, I know I shouldn't be eating all these things, but please stop, but don't.
I really like that.
Yeah, that's good.
Are y'all familiar with the Mahavishnu Orchestra?
Yes.
Say what? Yes.
Mahavishnu Orchestra and John McLaughlin, the great John McLaughlin, Mahavishnu.
Yes.
That's just a quick one I wanted to throw in there. I thought y'all probably were.
Yeah, Alan would definitely, if Alan was here, he could definitely go off on some
Mahavishnu. Yeah, a few years ago I saw a band, the bass player for the band Between the Buried and Me, if you're familiar. Uh-huh. I saw that their bassist is in a jazz trio who came to my town and played a tiny little dive bar. And they did a few Mahavishnu Orchestra covers in their set. And it was so the tightest shit I've ever seen. Just like, we got bass clarinet and bass guitar and drums. And that's all you need sometimes.
Wow. Yeah, Trio Escapes, right?
Trio Escapes. They were so tight. It was like a 50 capacity space, just fusion in your face. It was a good time.
Wow.
Hell yeah.
Yes.
I'm not a musician, but I feel like Flummox is music for musicians, as you said. It's like on another like line of thinking, I think it is music I would listen to even if I didn't love y'all, even if you weren't from here. I think it's still something I would listen to.
Y'all do cross a ground with that though, you know. I don't want to necessarily say that it's just that, because that's one of the things I was saying is that, you know, like take, you know, your common prog rock known band like Rush, you know, everybody can appreciate Rush. I love Rush to death, but I don't like every song they did. I can tell, you know, I really don't. And it's just me, you know, it's my taste. When bands really push the threshold like y'all do, it's walking a fine line of doing that, of being only musicians' music and not being palatable enough. But y'all seem to manage to do this. Y'all have a very, and y'all always seem to have this very image-based, like, little, it's almost like a show or your own little scene or your own little thing going on. Right, and it's, your references in music are back to references within your own music, you know, and it's very, very, I don't know really the term I'm trying to think. There's a lot of words that don't won't necessarily sound good if you use them, but it's not a bad thing. It's a really good thing, you know?
Mm-hmm. No, I understand. I mean, plus like, to an extent, I suppose with the music, I mean, Flummox is a theatrical entity in or out of the studio, in or off of the stage, right? And that's something that, as well as in the other group that I'm in, I've always been very conscious of how it's going to maybe go over in a live setting. Not that that necessarily determines a structure and or an arrangement, mm-hmm. but when we're thinking about how we're going to present it to people, we think about very, very deeply about how it's going to be presented. Again, whether in the studio or when we're going to perform it, because we're going to perform pretty much everything we write at one time or another. Like I said, the theatrical nature of it definitely shines through in both of those aspects, where we want to tell something that's larger than life, but also something that, you know, you just see the video and you just, like you said, all the imagery comes to you. It's just really, I don't know. I do really appreciate the compliment that it's more than musicians' music. Because Allie and I were just talking about this. Like, we've done shows where the audience was not necessarily into our particular brand of theatrics.
Right. Oh, but, you mean at the Milestone?
I wasn't gonna say North Carolina. I like North Carolina. North Carolina's.
You mean,
I have friends
in
North Carolina.
In Charlotte, North Carolina.
I need to know more about this.
That was a show.
I want you to finish your point before we go into that.
No, I wasn't even going to get into what happened in Charlotte.
Okay.
Maybe it was one of those Dr. John right place, wrong time things.
Well, because in any case, it wasn't
actually,
were cruel or anything. I was just trying to say that everyone in the other groups approached us afterwards and seemed very understanding of what we were going for. So,
besides that singer.
Think they understood what we were going for. That's not the impression I got anyway.
So that was to add on to this point and try to say into that, like, we do tend to think about, holy shit, what if we imagine like being this person who walks into a club and they see this going on. Mm-hmm. They walk in and see this band and they're doing this, and they're we never like write our music around a theatric. That always comes secondhand. Like, you know, when we wrote the Possum song before we came up with like what we were gonna do during the Possum, you know, bit or the sketch. I mean, we're just as influenced by like, you know, our favorite bands as we are like folks like Monty Python or like and then of course the more theatrical bands like Alice Cooper and others and stuff like that. So that being said, Charlotte, North Carolina was a famous
story time.
It's not that much of a story.
I mean,
I'm intrigued.
Tell what happened in Charlotte, Allison.
Alex has seen us before, so some of this won't come as a shock to you, but okay. So
it wasn't anything hateful or anything.
No, but like,
I think I already have an idea of what you did. Yeah.
So we were doing Black Phillip.
Mm-hmm.
And we do this bit where I'll set the scene first of all. Let's rewind it a little bit. We get told that we're playing this place called the Milestone, and like Nirvana's played there, and Bad Brains have played there, and it's a metal show, and like we walk into the venue, and it's covered in stickers. This place is cool, and like the staff was lovely, like the venue people loved us, and we loved them. But this was definitely like less of like our kind of metal, and more like the pop punk kids who like eventually became like who got like Escape the Fate albums later, and we played second and we got up there and we did Black Phillip, and I come out and I've got my goat skull mask on, I've got the hood, I have one of my tits out, and I'm breastfeeding the baby doll, and I lay it out pull the knife, I stab the baby doll over and over, pull it apart. Gummy worms are in there, you know? That's how it goes. It's the bit. Yo, like, the entire audience, when I started to present these to the audience, they just, you know? Wow.
See, I would think the gummy worms would be the, like, the icebreaker. Like, anybody up to the point of everything, they might be kind of freaked out. But then when you pull the gummy worms out, it'd kind of be like, oh, ha, ha, you know.
Well, yeah, I'm pulling the gummy worms out and eating them. And, like, and it usually goes, even places that we've never done it before, usually people catch on. You know, it's like, oh, cool, it's candy, right?
Right.
It's like, very Alice Cooper, like, shock rock silliness.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a total rip from Alice Cooper, really. But, like, well, like, you know, so I did what I did. I pulled the baby doll apart, and I started throwing pieces, chucking pieces at the audience. And, like, they tried to return the pieces during our set. Literally, we're finishing the song, and somebody like brings the two arms and the head, and just kind of puts it on the stage, you know. And so I just started stomping on them and kicking them. And then like after the gig, we played with this other band that night, and the singer was pretty good, you know. And I told him at the show, hey, you guys did great. You have a, you know, great voice or whatever, as you do. And he goes, you that second band? You were in that second band? Center stage? Yeah. I didn't like the baby thing.
That's so not metal. That's so right, right. Basically, what I heard out of that is you were way too hard for North Carolina.
Yeah.
You went
that particular bill.
And that was day first band two. Like day two. Day of two. Four. Wow. What a day two.
Was okay, so I gotta know, is there a specific reason that you, because the last time I've seen you perform Black Phillip, it was Red Hot still. Is there a reason for the candy change, or just is this arbitrary?
I think we haven't done Red Hot since like our second or third show doing it.
No. I don't mean to correct you about what you've done. I'm just kidding.
Honey.
No, I'm just kidding.
I stopped doing Red Hots a long time ago. But I've given you gummy worms.
I guess you haven't.
There is video of me putting gummy worms in your mouth.
Mm.
Down the
hatch. I'll have to go back and find that. You know what?
Might have to edit that.
I'll just accept this. Yeah, I'll just clip that in right here.
I will say this about the Red Hots. The reason I stopped doing Red Hots was after like the second or third show, I realized I'm literally just shoving. Because I mean, you know, the worst thing I do once I cut the baby open is I eat some of what's ever in there, you know? And I'm eating these Red Hots, and they're hot candy. They're cinnamon. They're Red Hots, and I have to sing.
Yeah,
So I had to stop that. Yeah. I had to stop that.
I can imagine.
That makes sense.
Gummy worms and Swedish fish.
Mm.
We did that for a while too.
On the topic,
but yeah, North Carolina was great.
On the topic of singing like that, do you find it easier or any difference singing on a full or empty stomach?
That's an interesting question.
That is an interesting question.
Yeah, because that is something I have to think about. I like to be somewhere in the middle. Okay. I've definitely played on an empty stomach a lot. Not right. So much a full stomach a whole lot, but like if I've eaten, but it's been like a few hours,
right,
that's probably where the sweet spot is.
Right, in general. I say that because anytime that I've had to sing, it's something that I've always made sure that, you know, if I'm on stage just playing and doing something, it's not that big of a deal. But I don't like to be very full anyway. But I've always tried to ask, you know, performing singers that often perform, you know, just different aspects, because I always find it interesting, because I have to pretty much be hungry. If I eat anything, it really kind of can throw off what I'm trying to do. It's just, you know.
No, I understand, because like reflux and that sort of thing, and I totally understand that.
So just one of those interesting, I guess, one of my, you know, mental survey questions.
Yeah, that's a good one, actually.
Yeah.
Oh, go ahead. Quick,
my friends. No, you're good. Sorry, I don't like keep like totally interjecting. It's hard doing this at work. Again,
you haven't interjected hardly at all.
Well, Okay, well, I feel rude, but okay, if y'all are okay, fine. I'm not sorry. I'm glad I did it. But I do have to go do a band transition, so I do have to get off the interview. But I just want to say thanks for having me on here, guys. I hope you guys have a great rest of your interview, and yeah, I'll talk to you guys soon.
Yeah. Bye, Chase. Thanks
for being here, Chase. Bye, Chase. You're my favorite member of the band.
You're all my favorite members of the band, even the interviewers.
Oh, thank you. Appreciate
you're
that.
You're in our band now, just so you know. Okay. Cool. Bye-bye.
Executive decision there.
Yep. I'll talk to you guys later. Bye-bye.
Bye.
He's not my favorite member of the band.
That was a fib.
We're getting the real skivvy here.
Yeah, this, you heard it here first, you know.
Blabbermouth.net tomorrow. Max hates Chase.
So, same question about the tummy feels to you, Max.
Whether or not I like to eat on an empty stomach or not. Let's see. I don't know. I never really thought about it, to be honest with you. But I don't know. I think somewhere in the sweet spot was honestly the answer I would probably give. Yeah. Right. You know, that's just where you want to be. Because like you said, if you eat too much, it's not feeling good. If you haven't eaten enough, then I don't know. But we're starving artists, so we're used to
right.
that.
Right. Right. I'm used to going on stage hungry.
If I had to choose, I'd probably play... I would say a full stomach, but it depends on how full. Like, is it full like I ate an hour ago, or is it full like I just got done eating pasta? Like,
right,
2 minutes ago.
What you eat, you know, dairy definitely coats you down, and you know, causes mucus.
Exactly.
Also
true.
There's been situations in recording vocals where that's been a plus. You know, just like
mucus.
I've had especially with female vocalists, I've had a lot of luck with them having sinus issues, you know, and still being able to pull it off, you know, and it almost give a different, I don't know, it's kind of strange, you know. We used to have a joke about Dayquil, you know, that would get us through sessions. It was not a good thing, but, you know, because you'd be like in and out. You know, half fever dreaming, but jeez, still managing to pull off the session.
Wow. I've had to do shows like where, you know, something like that. I had to, mm-hmm. you know, basically down Dayquil and whiskey and whatever.
The first show I ever did with you, you were sick as hell, if I recall.
When we did my first show in front of an audience after COVID was singing at the Basement East in front of, I'd say, at least a couple hundred people doing Ronnie James Dio, singing Ronnie James Dio.
Yeah.
That was a great
singing a lot of Ronnie James Dio.
A lot, like eight songs.
Uh-huh. You were sick?
I was sick.
She was very not well.
You were phenomenal.
That's, you know.
She was phenomenal.
I was drinking Dayquil. I was drinking hot tea. I had whiskey brought to me a couple times, like honey and whiskey. My vocal teacher actually happened to be one of the singers that night, and she was like, now do this. So I I still look at that performance and I'm like, damn, I could have done that better. Sick. So I did good, all things considered.
But you know, that's the show must go on mentality, sure. That, you know,
yeah,
that
I was freaking out a little bit,
especially pulling off some Dio that, you know, yeah, that's
I had to sing fucking Stargazer.
Oh God, that's right.
Yeah, and you killed it.
It was really good.
I saw y'all had done, that's been a while, y'all did Sabbath. Y'all did a Sabbath cover show, and I, you know, and Sabbath is one of those bands that I love them to death, but everybody can do them to death, you know. And, you know, y'all managed, you know, y'all did great with that, but stepping up and doing Dio was, that's a different level of something right there, you know. Especially because Dio has started to almost fell a little bit obscure, you know, to a lot of people. And it's kind of a shame because he was such a phenomenal singer. And, you know,
he's one of my favorites. So, you know, it just made sense to be a part of that. And we're probably going to do it again. They're doing it again. So,
oh, hell yeah. Nice.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Mm-hmm. So hopefully I won't be fucking sick.
Hey.
It's always like big shows, something like that happens to me, I swear.
You know, and funny enough, I wasn't going to say anything about the Dio thing, but that was the one and only time I got to see Flummox. That was the show where I came down and I was in the Dio show doing stuff with Allison and a few other folks like David, the drummer for Rainbow. And I got to watch Flummox do a few covers and I was like, wow, this band's pretty cool. I guess hopefully I won't join them in a month. and then now, but yes, that was fun. I really enjoyed watching Flummox, and now I will never have like I said, when I die, Gates of Hell, I'll still be in Flummox, so I'll never get to not see Flummox. But
yeah,
tis what tis, you know, as they say, as I say.
We'll just record it for you, Max, that way you can watch it back.
Oh, shut up.
Like, we don't do that anyway.
Yeah.
Well,
look at yourself. So this is something that I ask everybody too. And I know I asked Blake last time she was here, but Max, do you have any ghost stories or things you cannot rationalize with logic?
In 2015, I saw a ghost in Columbus, Ohio, and they headlined at the Newport Music Hall, where I just saw Between the Buried and Me. And I cannot fathom how terrible that band is. I actually really like Ghost. Their new album just came out on Friday. I'm just going to keep talking about Ghost. I just listened to it two or three times. I think it's good, well-crafted 80s arena rock. Things I can't fathom or understand. I encounter stuff like that every single day, my friend. So I would have to probably be more specific. But I'm going to stick with, yeah, the new Ghost album was pretty good. Okay. I think that they wrote some good stuff on that. And I'll never understand how they became so big.
Yeah, that's one of those supernatural phenomena I was asking for.
It's kind of a supernatural,
like, how, phenomenon. One of the seven wonders of the universe, right?
Like, no, I really do quite like them. They got good, catchy stuff.
I like the way they look.
That's the thing. Yeah, the theatrical stuff. I mean, you know me. You know.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's we're Flummox.
I have a question. And I'm sorry to Ghost. Okay, I'm sorry, but I do have a pet peeve with, like, fake spooky, and because, like, uh-huh. Flummox, you know what you're talking about.
We're real spooky.
There's, yeah. I really do have a real issue with, like, Tim Burton spooky, with mm-hmm. like,
I think there's a difference between, like, I don't know if, like, fake spooky is the right word, because it's certainly, like,
well, I think spooky.
Spooky.
You mean, like, poser? We should call it poser spooky.
Poser spooky.
Oh, God, it makes it sound like we work at a haunted house.
We're spooky posers.
Yeah. Spooky poser's a thing right now, and I don't.
But I think the term spooky is kind of hokey in its own right, yeah, you know.
I think
some people are
it's not exactly what I mean.
You know.
Yeah, no, I got you.
Spooky,
no stuff fun spooky.
We terrify.
You know, have some
Ghost comes out there and they do their little Halloween type show, and it's really great. Like, I mean, I saw Ghost on their first US tour here, like, 10 plus years ago. And it was sick.
Yeah, that sounds great.
But, you know, they've got this one sort of thing. We just, I think our spooky isn't necessarily, like, Halloween-ish, though. It's it's like we just walked in on something we weren't probably supposed to see.
Yeah. And if you're not doing it like that, goddammit, don't do it. That's my take. That's
for some weird, odd reason. Yeah. Ever since the possum popped up, it just seemed to be the perfect, you know, I don't know why, the possum and y'all, it's just, you know, it gives it that back swampy creepy brings about some genuine fear.
Some of that backwoods fucking.
Yeah.
Right. Right. I'm not sure if I wanted to come to this party, but I'm not going to leave just yet.
I'm sorry. I really like that. That's good.
Yeah.
That's,
I mean, like, that's when, like, it was when we play shows and parties like that. That's when we're like, we're home, you
Hell yeah.
know? Like,
Yeah.
when we're
It
playing in
really
the
is.
middle of, when we're playing in the middle of the fucking woods somewhere, that's when it's like, oh yeah. Or just like in somebody's backyard where there's a bonfire going and like there's like 100 people there and they're all fucking stone ass queer hippies, just something, you know, like that's just is where it's at, you know, and like
Yeah.
we're
that we're the we're spooky to
I guess the other thing that you all have on Ghost is you're all extremely talented.
Oh God.
Oh,
So
they
if
were
you're
going to say gay.
Oh, that too.
That's fair. Hey, I'll take that. No, ghosts are talented. Like Dave
Oh
Grohl,
yeah.
like
one of
Right,
the
I'm
best.
done shitting on Ghost. I'm sorry. But
Mobius Forge is a good songwriter. It's just he's Tim Burton spooky, as you say.
Yeah, he has a very pointed perspective on how he wants to present the type of spooky that he is. And like I said, it's good fun. That's the difference between them and us. Is you go to a Flummox show, you're not there to have fun. You're there to
What?
like you said, you go there.
You're there just to look at the weird animals in the cage that have different appendages than other
Yeah, the
animals.
people in Charlotte had the more proper reaction than how most people, you know, sensible people, would react to what it is that we do. But yes, I get what you're saying about the fake spooky. Like I said, like Flummox doesn't spook people; we terrify. So that's probably the difference.
That's, you know. Yeah.
Probably.
I don't know. I go through the whole circuit of emotions at a Flummox show, like
It's
me
arousal,
too.
complete utter fear,
it's fun, but some people maybe the majority of people, you know, aren't expecting that kind of fun. And
Oh,
some of us
absolutely. They don't know how to have fun.
search that kind of fun out because it's kind of rare to see that kind of fun and talent and, you know, and interest, something interesting, you know.
Yeah, it's entertainment, you know, because the thing is, at the end of the day, it's the whole package. Like people go to see bands, and we're really sick of the prog bands who stand on their X's on the floor and just do their thing. You know, like, because it's, you know, it's, you know, and again, here's another band that I was quite fond of who are very guilty of this. It's a band called Dream Theater. You know, they're those type of bands that just stand there and they're very proficient, and I will never take that away from them. I think they can write some good songs, but the fact of the matter is their presentation is very much reliant on like background visuals, a light synchronization, like synchronized to the crazy time signatures or something to that effect. But it's not necessarily about coming to see the people do something super unexpected. Like you're gonna get John Petrucci playing the best guitar parts you've ever heard. Like, okay. Or at least the most technically proficient. And you go to a Flummox show, we take pride in the entertainment factor. It's very much you go there and you're not paying $10 to watch us futz around doing the hummingbird shit. You're gonna watch five people going absolutely fucking nuts. And you never know what's gonna happen. I don't know what's gonna happen. 5 minutes before the show, Allie comes up and goes, "Hey, this is stupid." And then I just have to do that. So like, you know, like it's very
It's
much
100% happened like that.
yeah. Since I've been in the band, like I said, you were talking about fear. I'm in fear. I fear for myself that during the Flummox shows, the first day of the last Flummox show, I got hit in the head with a bass by our bass player who should remain nameless.
That
But
was your fault.
and it was my fault. But then the second day of the show, she like jumped on, climbed up on the amplifier on all fours like a fucking thing, and just was like wearing a possum mask, and I'm like, I'm scared. We're all scared. So at least we're, you know, we're in it together. But like I said, the entertainment aspect of it is very important. We want the live show to feel like a unique experience each time. And I think that we're very proficient. And like I said, entertainment. It's all a big package, you know.
It
If we
is
want to make it, we got to bring more than a regular band.
well, what y'all are doing is bringing what the late great Lux Interior called what rock and roll is. You know, it's not a music, it's not a genre. He said it's the constant sense of urgency and danger. And when you can give that to a crowd, you know, that's what drives them, you know, and that's why, you know, you listen to Cramps and everything's simple. Half the shit they did was a cover. But oh my God, nobody had stage energy like that band, you know, and bands like that, it whether it's simple rockabilly, whether it's prog, whether it's whatever it is, if you're given everything you got, because you're just in love with what you're doing anyway. You know, it comes across, you know, and as people see that, you know, and they feel
absolutely.
It.
It's like, Max, you summed up like all of my favorite prog bands with the like standing on it. Why is that so universally true? It's like,
what were you going to say? I don't want to interrupt your point.
Oh, like Polyphia, Animals as Leaders. Like I love, those are two of my favorite bands, but like they stand in the same spot and they just are super extremely proficient at what they do.
Mm-hmm.
And
it's like,
y'all do that, but you're jumping around.
Yeah. Like,
I don't know if our music is technically as hard as some of that stuff. If you want to go technically, you know, because like why people go to a Polyphia or an Animals as a Leader show is more to basically just see people be really, really proficient. You know, it's a totally different kind of thing.
It's definitely part of
like jazz.
I get what you're saying, like, but jazz. I mean, like maybe not exactly that proficient. And I mean, I'm not a musician, so how do I know? But it looks really impressive. It looks like you're doing almost the same thing.
We're doing
not the same thing, but the same level.
To me, it's about this. And it's thing is, at what point does the technical proficiency cross over into being like that's a valuable substitute to what it is we're doing? Because it's like, is this band so technically good that it doesn't matter that they're just standing there? Or maybe, you know, because, you know, they'll give the odd head tilt to the audience. Because I've seen all those bands. I've seen Animals as Leaders a bunch of times. I've seen Polyphia. And the thing is, while they're very good, and the thing is, a lot of those bands, you know, like the Chons and the Dream Theaters, you have to kind of just stand there during big swaths of the set, because you just, if you move around too much, you risk screwing up the difficult aspects of the music. But it's like, I don't know. To me, it's like, again, at what point does it just start to be everyone just standing there admiring some people who practiced a lot versus going to see a rock show? Right. And
bingo.
The bands with longevity, I think, are bands that are constantly willing to do something different and fresh in their set. And because, again, the best way to still get out there and kind of make a living in a big way is to be a personality, to be someone that people can latch onto in one way or another. And if you can do that on stage, then you're already winning a big part of that battle, in my opinion. So I think prog bands, the disappointing part is you think of progressive and you think of it as this term that means limitless. At least I do. And a lot of prog bands are just very, very technically proficient, time signature heavy, you know, technical metal bands. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's not necessarily what progressive should be about. It's not
it's
about.
Like, it's like yeah. Prog. It's prog. It's like it's what it's a bastardized kind of version of bands that were progressive once upon a time. You know.
And even to me, I've become really disillusioned with the term progressive rock, because it has come to stop meaning a pushing of the envelope, and it has come to mean a specific period of time where a certain style of music was created, and that is now a sound to draw from. So it's no longer progressive.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah, it's like
bands that sound like Yes, or bands that sound like
you sound like Genesis, right? You know, or King Crimson, and those bands are way cooler than whatever anyone is aping them is trying to do, except us.
That's a good point. Prog's more than just being technically proficient. I totally agree. It's like, you brought up Rush as an example of a prog band, and that was weird to me because that's from before my time. So I don't think of Rush as a
prog band. A lot of people don't think of them as a prog band. It's just that they were probably much like Yes. People know Yes from Owner of a Lonely Heart, which was their least prog track of all time.
I know Yes from Roundabout.
And then Roundabout, which was pretty good, but they don't, that's, if you go even deeper in on those records, you get into some stuff that's just, you know, really pushing what people weren't doing, you know?
Yeah, Roundabout, even on Fragile, isn't one of the craziest, like most,
right.
Pushing envelope type tracks, which isn't a bad thing, but you know what I mean.
I mean, you can usually tell that because, you know, the things that can hit the radio are usually the less proggy, if you want to say, you know, because they have an appeal to them. Rush was kind of an anomaly because you have the drummer writing poetry that a singer, bass player, keyboardist is fitting into vocals. So it was really so many things going on with them, with a display of talent plus a display of songwriting ability. And also being allowed to do whatever they want, but they didn't have a whole lot of hits compared to how many records they put out, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it was just three of them too. Three of them making all that music was probably a big part of it, I think.
Right. Yeah. You know, it's, you know, three pieces. I think three pieces are some of the best bands of all time were three pieces, you know.
Yeah, but, like Rush was definitely an influence on us early on for sure.
Comets was a trio for a good while in the, right. in the early days.
For the first like 4.5 years of this band, yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, and that's a group that also managed to beat it in another way because they had personalities. Like you could latch on to a Geddy Lee, like you remember. And it's not necessarily because he's trying to do a particular thing, just the way he looks and the way he sings. Right. And like you said, the way they write, because again, Owner of a Lonely Heart and Roundabout for Yes, you know, it's they're those songs that have the prog elements, but they're the hooks that people yep. can remember. So, absolutely. You know, like you said, those are the ones that'll hit the radio, but they definitely were groups that set a precedent. Like I still love several of those bands a lot. Like Yes were a huge formative one for me, at least as far as progressive music. I really, really love Yes. I still listen to them a lot.
Now, in that era, since we're around that era, y'all, it seems that Floyd was studied properly throughout this band.
Chase's favorite band is Pink Floyd.
Right.
Is that true? I didn't know that. No wonder he's my least favorite member of the band.
His only tattoo is a Pink Floyd tattoo.
Is that what that is? I didn't know that was a wall. I love Pink Floyd, by the way. I don't know them super duper great, but we definitely are fans, I would say.
Well, it's a band that kind of, you know, you could call them prog because they literally did what they were going to do. But they are, a lot of people credit them with being the first band to have concept albums. And, you know, they, a lot of people consider it to be Dark Side. That really was the first concept written album to be, you know, this is a piece as a record, because recording of full length records was still in its early years at that point, you know, recording music was still relatively a new thing. And an LP was the way to go. You know, you're starting to get around 8-track time. So you've got a lot of aspects of that. That it goes back to that Dark Side was an amazing work, but what's really amazing about it is how many radio hits are on it, how many songs off of that record they put on the radio, and they have to cut them because they're all running together because it's a it's a concept
that record. Is pretty crazy,
and
it's a staggering amount. They play like that whole record, at least here in Ohio they do, like on the radio. It's bananas.
Yeah, I mean there's almost, I don't know of any song I can say on there that I never heard on the radio.
Yeah, I think I've heard all of them. I will say as far as the concept stuff, well, I'm sorry, I didn't know if that actually, what was your point? I don't know about Pink Floyd.
Yeah, it kind of falls under the prog, you know, because it is, as we're talking about, progressive, real progressive music, not just the genre of prog. It's saying we're going to do something that,
You pointed out, there being a genre to prog is kind of redundant.
Right. You know, it's like, these are the bands that in, you know, it's like, you know, punk, you look at punk. Punk was punk because only when you said it wasn't punk, you know, the kind of thing, you know, it was anti-establishment. So everything that comes out wasn't what it was to the people that invented it. It's to us in retrospect. You know, we look back at these bands as prog bands. They probably weren't calling themselves prog. They weren't going out there. You know, we're rock bands. You know, everything was rock and roll.
Yeah.
You know.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. For sure.
So it's, you know, the influences I find really, really interesting to connect, and then also find the differences, because, like you're saying, you know, y'all have. Seem like y'all have a broad appreciation of some of the same bands, but some of y'all seem, y'all point out different members that say, well, that's so, you know, that's his favorite band, and this is so-and-so else, you know, they know more about this band, you know. And I think that's really one of the most interesting elements when it comes to a band that is really doing their own thing like you guys are, because you can't, that's why you can pinpoint all these elements in there, but nothing makes y'all sound like any of those bands. You know, I can't say y'all sound like any of those bands, but as a musician, you pull that out, you know?
Yeah.
And I think that's part of the palatability, because other non-musicians don't really know. They're like, I don't know what it is about it.
I think it, like, you know, it all comes down to, you aren't trying to sound like anything. You're just making the things you want to make. And that is what a real artist is. It's not about money or fame, although that might be nice. It's more like, I have to do this or I'll go insane. And people enjoy it, so I'm putting it out for them to share. I mean, I'm speaking for myself. That's how my creative process, but I assume that's true of y'all. It's, even if no one was paying attention, I know you would be doing this anyway.
I mean, yeah, we've been doing it since people weren't paying attention, you know. Yeah. And now they kind of are, so that's cool. But I hate some folks. But it's just, you know, it's art. It's art expression, you know. Don't know what else I would be doing besides this right now. Glad I'm still at it.
Yeah.
To me, I think a crucial thing to mention also is just having fun and coming up with something, like, you know, it was like I was saying, it's the same as the live show. Allie comes up and says, what if we did this stupid thing in our music? And I go, that sounds like it would be funny. And then we just do it, you know, and it's like those.
And then at the end of the set, I'm covered in, I have my tits covered in paint and I'm dressed like Santa. And it's awesome.
It was, again, fear. I was fearful. It's like enjoying yourself, you know, because a lot of those, like you said, we're a combination of all these different things. And ultimately, at the end of the day, we just want to make music. And it isn't really an intentional choice to make something that feels so different, because we've been writing this new stuff for this next record. And in when we're in the room working on it together, I don't even know what to call it. Like, it's not coming from a certain place. Like, I can maybe tell, like, oh, our drummer Alan will throw in a polyrhythm that I kind of feel like comes from fusion or maybe modern progressive music. But then, you know, Allie's doing some Primus bullshit over that, you know. And then we have Chase, the very modern minor music, a school of like the delay and the big, you know, washy effects. And our keyboardist is a wild card, so you never know how all those things are going to come together. But yeah, I will say, not to touch back too much on the Floyd, I guess, but I have a soft spot in my heart for the Wall. They were one of those bands who I feel were progressive without having to necessarily take it to the uber technical level all the time. Because I don't feel like Dark Side is a terribly complicated instrumentally record. Right. And although I will say, if I were to think of like concept records before that, I got to give it to Who's Tommy as one of the earliest ones I have a soft spot for the Who's Tommy. I actually used to work for a ballet organization, and we put on a production of the Who's Tommy in Ohio.
I think it falls out of being considered a concept because it was like a soundtrack. You know,
well, I suppose. I mean, it's a story.
A story, but it's it's based around a soundtrack. You know, and that's what I'm saying. It was always arguable. And I don't know that if Floyd even said this is a concept
album. That's more like people attribute it.
People just kind of said that's what this is, because, you know.
Yeah, exactly.
Pink Floyd's like, what the fuck's a concept record? What are you talking about?
I think
we're just really high.
Yeah. it's when you write the whole album on one dose.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Well, I won't take up too much of your ladies' time. I just have one more question for you.
Sure.
In the Hummingbird Anthem video, you all are furries. My question is, are the furry animals that you are in the song, is that your fur affinity? Is that your soul? Is that your spirit animal?
One day we're getting these questions.
White people don't have spirit animals.
Fair enough.
We have fursanas.
And if those aren't your fursanas.
I've been dressing up like an opossum on stage in front of people for like 5 years, so I can't really add anything else to my answer.
No, we're not furries, to answer your question. Although
speak
I will
yourself, say, Max.
I'm not, And I chose to be a fox because I thought it would be cute. For the record, I wanted to be a conglomeration of bugs. And
that was way too hard to animate.
We decided naturally
that it would be difficult
to animate.
That reminds me of that Rick and Morty bit of 1 million ants. It's like, is this the guy? He is the composition of 1 million ants. That's, yeah. That would have been great. I can see how Haven might have had a hard time animating that, though.
Well, and you see how efficiency sometimes is art itself.
Yes. I mean, I feel more like a million bugs, but, sometimes you just got to take
it. I feel like that's great.
I feel like a million bugs.
I feel like a million bugs. I'm just like, ah! But, sometimes you just got to take it. You got to take it for what you get. Somebody's got to be a fox. You just got to be like, all right, I'm gonna be a fox in this video.
You're quite a fox, Max.
Yeah, I'm aware.
So I would like for you two to speak for the rest of Flummox. What are their fur affinities? What are their fursonas? Are they accurate to the video?
Alan's is not. Because Alan loves dogs.
Yeah, Alan's a dog.
Hmm. Yeah, he's a beaver in the video, and that's funny. And it's funnier and it makes sense, but no. Jesse is a deer. I think that totally makes sense.
He's a regal gazelle.
Chase is a big bear who roars sometimes, like when it's important, and I think that works for him. Except the bear wasn't wearing a hat in the video, and that's where I call bullshit.
He's our hat guy.
He's our hat man.
Chase wears the hat in the band.
He wears the hat in this band. That's absolutely true. Just the one.
Does anyone wear pants?
No.
No.
Not allowed.
No pants on.
That's usually,
Yeah, that should be mandatory for anyone attending your shows also, I think.
I feel like that would be a problem.
Blake said, no, I'm not okay with that.
I know who comes to our shows.
Yeah.
I've seen what a lot of them already look like without pants.
I feel like it might smell a lot worse too.
I mean,
maybe
that's just insensitive.
Use your imagination.
That's just insensitive.
I've also smelled many of our fans, and let me tell you what,
some of them smell just fine.
Some of them smell just fine.
Some of them are not offensive.
Most of them smell probably. I don't know, but I don't know.
It's, probably.
But yes, no pants, Flummox shows, spread the word. If that's the one thing, take that sound bite, use that. Flummox fans, don't wear pants.
I think we might be able to clip that out and put it at the beginning or something.
I think I'm gonna have quite a fun time.
Yeah.
Editing this.
We certainly did.
We gave you a mess to edit.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
hey, it's a hot mess, so.
Alice, Don't Mix Reflummox, streaming everywhere April 1st. You can also catch Flummox at the basement, right? I keep messing that up.
Yes, we're at the basement. And then we're doing a little tour, going to Nashville, then Louisville, then Cincinnati, then Chicago, then Lafayette, and then we're going to go home.
Nice.
And sleep. And on April Fool's Day, it all kicks off. So be there, be square, and don't forget because it's not a joke.
No, it's not. We're not joking. No. Really gonna play a show.
Wouldn't it be funny if nobody showed up?
Wouldn't it be no?
No,
It'd be funny if you joke about that.
It would be funny if everyone else showed up except you guys. It's like, I can't believe you guys fell for that.
We thought about it.
Daylight savings. It just makes everything. That's why we missed the show.
Daylight savings. That's brilliant. That's a good one.
Well, Alice, we'll catch you next time on the rabbit hole, and links below for the Flummox.
Absolutely.
We are the Flummox.
Bye.